Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kip Dexel, and as a partner of the law firm McMillan, it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you here today. I'm also welcoming you in my capacity as Corporate Secretary of the Canadian Council for the Americas. Our law firm, McMillan, is one of Canada's leading business law firms, and it has a very strong national presence with five offices across the country and a very active international outreach to certain regions of the globe, including Latin America, where we were quite active last year helping clients, mostly Canadian clients, doing business in the region. We are also a very, very enthusiastic supporter of the Canadian Council for the Americas, which is an increasingly important bridge between the business community, I should even say maybe business communities of Canada and the world of Latin America and the Caribbean. Last year was an exciting year for the Canadian Council for the Americas, and I know that the board and our management and our leadership are very enthusiastic about the prospects for this year. And in fact, we had very good news just yesterday because the former Minister of Trade, who, as you know, was in a sense, I think we could say, was promoted to become our foreign minister, knows the CCA very well, has worked with us very closely in her previous capacity. So I know the Council looks forward to working with her even more closely with her new responsibilities. So that's very exciting. I'm just curious, of the people here, how many have been to these previous economic roundtables? Okay, so you know that it will be the seventh time that we've actually done this. And those of you who've been here before will know that it's always a seminal event for the CCA and one in which our attendees get a great deal of insight in the region. And actually, I was coming up in the elevator with Pablo, who's been involved in this for a number of years, and I asked him if he ever checked his predictions from the previous year, and he said he actually went on the tape and double-checked, and he actually got a lot of things right. So that's encouraging, because most prognosticators don't usually get it that right. So all the more reason for being here, and it's also one of the reasons why we tape the proceedings. So if afterwards you'd like to see it again or pass it on to any friends, please feel free to do so. So it's my pleasure now to introduce you to Martha Blackwell, who is our Vice President and Director of Programming, who will talk to you a bit about upcoming events of the CCA, and will introduce our panelists. Thank you for being here. Martha.
Thanks, Kip, and thanks again to McMillan for hosting us this morning. I just want to first start off with thanking our premium members, including Barrick Gold, Ontario Teachers Pension Plan, Scotiabank, as well as our gold members, ATCO, the Caisse de Depot, Goldcorp, Kinross, KPMG, Lundin Mining, National Bank, SNC-Lavalin, and TMX. So thank you to those sponsors who give us the opportunity to put these kinds of events on. So I'll start off by introducing Ken Frankel. He's the president of the CCA and will be moderating the panel today. It's a pleasure to include Inés Bustillo, who is the director of the Washington Office of the United Nations Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean. This is the first time, I think Kip mentioned, that it's the first time that she's actually joining us on this panel, so we're very happy to have her with us here today. Next to her, we've got Pablo Bréard, who's the Vice President and Head of International Economics and the Chief Latin American Economist, responsible for Emerging Market Intelligence at Scotiabank. Next to Pablo, we've got John Price, who is Managing Director of America's Market Intelligence. And last but not least, we have Jonathan Hausman, Managing Director and Head of Global Strategic Relationships at Ontario Teachers Pension Plan. I will hand it over to Ken now to get started with the panel. And thank you all again for being with us here this morning, and thanks to those who are joining us online.
Thank you, Martha, and thank you, Kip. I too went to the tape of the event last year, and two things immediately stuck out in my mind. One was there's significantly more facial hair on the panel this year, which is a neutral thing, I would say. And a positive side, there seems to be a little bit less poundage than there was last year as well. So that's a good thing. There's a lot to cover today, as there is every year when we do these events, and it's great to see so many returning people who've been to these events in the past. And so I don't want to spend a lot of time doing an introduction, but let me just start off by setting the table a little bit about the year that happened, and then we'll have some discussion about that before we then move into what's going to happen in the year ahead, which obviously will predominate the conversation. But by my calculation, my informal calculation, during 2016, we witnessed in Latin America one impeachment, one deeper descent into economic and social chaos, one monumental peace agreement with another en route, two very surprising election results. I'm talking specifically about Peru and the United States. One monumental economic and political turnaround attempted, or still in the process, and there's Argentina. One monumental economic turnaround in limbo, and that would be Brazil. Two treading water economically and politically waiting for its 2017 elections. There's a few of those. One increasingly engaged superpower, which is China, and only one consensus admired political leader in the hemisphere, which I'm happy to say is Prime Minister Trudeau of Canada. And those of us who accompanied him on his trip to South America in November can attest to the fact that he is admired, and people and the leaders in the hemisphere are looking to him for to take a bigger role in this hemisphere, and hopefully he will. We think that he will. In 2017 coming up, we have two presidential elections, Ecuador and in Chile, two pre-election maneuverings for 2018. I know every year is a pre-election maneuvering, but I think we're going to be looking closely at what happens in Colombia and Mexico. And one very critical congressional election, which is coming up in a number of months, which is Argentina. Now, on the economic front, and I don't want to walk over what Inés is going to say, but the region as a whole contracted a little bit more than 1%, which is the first time since the early 80s that there's been two consecutive years of economic contraction in the region. It's a little bit misleading. South America contracted by 2.4%. Central America was up 3.6%. And the Caribbean was down by 1.7%. Now, why do I say it's misleading? Well, if you look at the table of countries that we're talking about 2016, it's a little bit skewed in South America, with Venezuela contracting by almost 10%, 9.7%, Brazil down at 3.6%, Ecuador contracted, and Argentina, which was expected, did. We think that the discussion about what happens in 2017 will hopefully look a little bit brighter, particularly in certain countries, not all of them. And so there are other countries where there hasn't been a contraction, where there has been growth, a bit moderate, of course, but growth. And that we're going to examine all these themes today, and we will have time for a lot of engagement with the audience and the folks who are here, so you can test some of your ideas and probe our experts to get specific answers to specific questions that you have. So without any other introduction, I'd like to ask Inés, who, by the way, I am also ecstatic that you're here. As you know, I've known Inés for many, many years, and I've been chasing around Washington for as many years to get her to come here, and so we're really particularly welcome that you could, and happy that you could come today. So if you wouldn't mind giving a review or an overview of what happened in 2016 and a little bit about what you see coming ahead.
Okay, great. Well, thank you, Ken. It's wonderful to be here, so thank you very much for the invitation to be in Toronto. As Ken was saying, last year, 2016, was not a good year. For the region as a whole, output declined by 1.1%. It was a second consecutive year of economic growth declining. But since 2010, the economies had been decelerating. So it's something that had been happening, and mostly on account of changes in the international economy. Changes such as global growth had been very mediocre. Demand from China had been slowing down. Global trade had been growing very little. And the terms of trade, which was critical, the terms of trade deteriorated for mostly South American economies. So as Ken was saying, there's quite a lot of diversity And the decline was, in the case of South America, by 2.4%. In the case, for example, of Central America, the economies slowed down, but continued increasing at a rate of, for the subregion as a whole, 3.6%. And Mexico grew, slowed down a little bit, but grew at 2%. And the economies of the Caribbean, as Ken was saying, declined by 1.7%. So mostly what explains that is the terms of trade that turned against natural resource exporters. And there were significant declines in the terms of trade, a little bit less than in 2015 in oil, copper, etc. All projections are that those prices will improve in 2017. So there was diversity depending on whether the economies were natural resource exporting countries or economies that depended more on manufacturing and tourism. Now, it was a tremendous terms of trade shock that we've seen. What we are seeing in terms of financial variables is that, as opposed to previous times of previous crisis, so far, and it's important to mention the word so far, financial variables seem to be okay. There is a lot of instability, but I mean, countries have been having access to, for example, international bond markets. When we look at the figures between January and October, the region issued bonds 50% more than in the previous year. It was mostly attributed to Argentina and Brazil. In terms of foreign direct investment declined by 9% in 2015. We have not released the numbers yet for 2016. Those will come out in May. But we expect foreign direct investment to have declined a little bit as well, or stayed about the same. Now, this is in the context of a global decline in foreign direct investment. However, that is mostly explained for foreign direct investment that have gone to mining, etc. There are sectors where there are wonderful opportunities, and foreign direct investment has keep increasing, mostly in the area, for example, of telecommunications and renewable resources, etc. Now, countries have been trying to adjust to this situation with different types of fiscal space. Some countries have more fiscal space than others, and things have been easier for those countries. However, the adjustment has not been easy. And in addition to that, there are the problems that we've seen right now with external events, which have some currencies have depreciated. So there's the challenge of boosting the economy in a context of depreciating exchange rates. But inflation has increased for the region as a whole from 8 to 10% in some countries. Three countries in particular, it has increased considerably, and it's very worrisome. But prices in the Latin American region as a whole have started to go down. So I think there's a little bit more space coming from that front. Now, the worrisome aspect is that this adjustment that is taking place is already having an impact on employment indicators and poverty indicators. Unemployment for the region increased last year, and in some countries, in the case of Brazil, it was over 12%. And poverty, which was a great accomplishment of the region as a whole between 2002 and 2010, poverty declined, according to our numbers, from 43% to 28% of the population. I mean, 40 million people came out of poverty. Poverty reduction has stagnated. And we're going to be releasing our figures later on this year. And we are expecting that poverty could have increased somewhat. And that is very worrisome. We do not want the adjustment to really affect the main gains that took place in the past years on the social arena. Now, we're expecting things to improve in 2017. And you can find our latest numbers on our website. For the region as a whole, we're expecting growth to be of 1.3%. And in all countries, we expect an improvement. An improvement on account that natural resource prices will be a little bit better, and on account that global trade, even though not growing at the rates that used to grow, will improve a little bit, and global demand as well. But this will take place in a context of tremendous uncertainty. So let me finish by saying that I think the region as a whole has to prepare for a situation of tremendous uncertainty and a new normal of probably increased protectionism, global demand that will not be as dynamic as before, terms of trade that are not going to be as favorable as before, and that will affect, of course, tourism, remittances, etc. And therefore, the adjustment has to take place in such a way to try to preserve as much as possible the social gains. We're particularly concerned that public investment has been dropping for 8 consecutive trimesters, and that has an impact on future growth. But at the same time, it's a time to be bold and aggressive with respect to dealing with some of the structural problems that the region has faced in the past years. And that means dealing with the low technological context of production and exports, the low productivity, and invest in infrastructure, education, and reshape the insertion that the region has in global markets. And we can discuss that later on. It means reshaping the relationship with Asia. It's keeping ahead with an agenda of opening more markets and also integrating within the region. And that means being very pragmatic and have a very ambitious agenda of trade facilitation of infrastructure. So let me finish there.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Inés. I have a number of questions I want to ask right away, but I want to move on, and we'll have time to come back to have discussions about a lot of those, because a lot of those things you mentioned are things that require a fair amount of investment. So it's a question of having the government invested time when theoretically its revenues are less, and so how that balance works. I'd like to move on to now, we're going to do the Southern Cone. We'll start off with Brazil, and I'd like to call on Jonathan to discuss that. Everybody knows what's been going on in Brazil, a political uncertainty unlike any other country, with the exception of Venezuela, I would say. Attempted reform packages, a bit of a lame duck interim president before elections in 2018. Jonathan, what do you see is happening in Brazil going forward?
Well, of course, I look at the scenario in the Americas through the lens of investment, which is not necessarily doesn't have to diverge from one of development, but it's about timing, really. Our job is to try to find the bottom or close to the bottom. Sometimes the bottom is followed by a long period of adjustment, which can be painful, but markets are trying to anticipate. So we have to sort of make that early call as to whether we've reached a level of pricing for these assets reflecting the problems that exist and the problems that could occur in time. In Brazil, I guess I'll make a bold statement. I would say that has been reached probably 6 months ago, but the boldness of investors has been somewhat tempered because of the uncertainty that Inés and others have pointed to. It's a schizophrenic approach that the markets have to Brazil. On the one hand, foreign direct investment in Brazil has barely changed, which is to say that most of the people who are investing bricks and mortar are not changing their perspective that Brazil is where they need to be. So it's actually been the best story, arguably, in emerging markets because it hasn't changed, even though there's been all manner of problems. I mean, as you pointed out, both structural, political, and economic, and arguably social. On the other hand, capital markets, liquid markets, have been all over the place. But they are now, and I really say 6 months ago because I think a trend got established about 6 months ago, which was a trend that has generally seen the currency appreciate. It has generally seen the anticipation of a disinflationary process, which is now well in hand. You may see the IPCA numbers from yesterday are actually better than expected. So inflation actually might roll down right to the inflation target, at least the top end of the inflation target of the Central Bank of Brazil, which is something that nobody thought would happen a year and a half ago, including, I think, Mr. Goldfein. And thirdly, credit spreads in the country have improved, although I want to talk about that. So If you look at the gestalt of Brazil a year and a half ago and Brazil today, it looks from a macroeconomic point of view fundamentally not that great. Growth is not going to break zero next year. Unemployment, as Inés mentioned, is going to grow, not shrink. Balance sheets of households will shrink, not grow. And truthfully, you could have a process with the economists called hysteresis, which is the economy doesn't know how to grow anymore. It's shrunken to a point where it can't get those animal spirits back. All that said, though, the prices of assets, particularly because of the interplay of politics and the corruption scandal and what is really an internal banking strike, essentially, against companies by the local banks, because of the risks that these companies present to them in terms of you never know which CEO is going to go to jail next, has created a pricing environment which is very attractive to foreign direct investors and to, frankly, and to financial investors like ourselves. So I want to just talk about two phenomena that are out there that I think demonstrate, I think, a more hopeful outlook for Brazil on even the fundamental basis. Even if 2017 is kind of a poor year, things that I think are undeniable. Number one is politics. So it used to be, when we were all very excited about having a PT government that that had some consistency, if not, frankly, very good people, there was a coalition that could get a few things done, particularly in the first term of Lula, which was a good term for Brazil, and frankly, the second term was sort of bad, and Dilma's term was a disaster. But we were always saying, oh, well, you know, Brazil's finally got a government that's got some consensus and we could get things done. Actually, despite the fact that Temer did not get elected, per se, as president, and the fact that six of his ministers have always been carted off to prison, and I expect another two, at least, and two important ones, including Franco, to be carted off. Amazingly, the coalition around the fiscal package, the pension reform, is actually stronger today with a PMDB phalanx in Congress than it was before. So actually you have a 60 to 68 deputy cushion to get things done that did not exist before. That's the first point. The second one is central bank. Now, the central bank, I've argued for I don't know how many, over two decades with various central bank governors in Brazil, but why the central bank in Brazil should be independent. And they would give me all sorts of very sophistic arguments as to why that shouldn't be, and I still don't understand it. But nonetheless, I do think that the central bank has gotten back some of its operational independence now. And more importantly, you have a rhyming, maybe more than rhyming, maybe actually a simultaneity and homogeneity of thought between the key economic engines and organizations in the economy. Petrobras is run by a genius, and that is a massive change. The central bank, Ilan Goldfein, probably the best central banker in the country. I mean, Fraga would probably argue with that, but that's okay. You have very strong people in BNDES, which used to be, of course, under Coutinho was like basically slush fund number two. And you have in finance a very strong minister, very experienced from the central bank. So you have this unity, which is very, and Temer, whose instincts are basically conservative. We don't know exactly what the tail risk associated with his leadership is, but basically conservative and very formal, which actually in this case is a good thing. Maybe a bit boring, but frankly boring is good. So that policy homogeneity is extremely important to underpin what we're seeing in terms of reform. Last comment, I talked about the credit strike. This is very unusual. Usually in emerging markets you have an external strike, actually capital strike, but actually you have an internal capital strike. It's very, very weird. I think that might change. I think that might change due to the fact that foreigners are holding their positions in Brazil, and the locals now, I think, are beginning to figure that, you know what, this disinflationary path will lead to lower interest rates, that will lead to more animal spirits, that will lead, even in the face of these very, very negative economic fundamentals, into a more positive outlook in 2018. With low inflation. So I think that you might begin to see the stirrings of those internal capital providers beginning to come back. So I think that 2017 will be a little better than people think. I think 2018 will be a lot better than people think.
Thank you. Great. Thank you. Pablo, did you want to say something about Brazil?
Yes and no. Well, first is thank you for inviting and trying to mimic some of the comments that you said, Ken and Inés and Jonathan. And if I may take one of your last observations, said our job is to try to find the bottom and timing. And I was just checking the rate of the pound sterling versus the Canadian dollar as we speak at 1.60. Is that a bottom, you know? So, and with that, it's an opening statement of what 12 months ago we were here all sitting. We were sitting 12 months ago in the middle of probably a major, major financial market crash. You know, oil prices were around $25, 26, you know, for the pure. China was starting to lose foreign exchange reserves. By the time they had lost probably $500 billion reserves when we were sitting here from the peak of June 2014. And all the equity markets were crashing. And we were here just trying to map out a view for Latin America. So clearly, nobody wanted to hear our view on Latin America, rather what was going to happen with the world at the time. 12 months ahead, we're just finishing with a lot of events that you highlighted. Some of them were probably exacerbated by the developed country media, which is, you know, the elections in the US and the Brexit. Nobody talked about, for instance, the parliamentary elections in Japan that gave Shinzo Abe the right to change the constitution to rearm its country. A major creditor of the US, by the way. Or nobody talked about that China was going to lose another, you know, wave of foreign exchange reserves. By the way, China has lost $1 trillion in reserves, which is around a quarter of what they had at their peak. And nobody was talking about that. I consider that an extremely material event. Going back to your words, and I quote, you can, super engaged, superpower, we have to be extremely careful about China. Still today and 12 months ahead. That is a 2017 issue. How many trillions of dollars are you gonna use to defend your currency, to stop capital outflows, which I would love to hear Jonathan Hausman's at the end, you know, what his view on China capital markets are. So what we're talking about, an election in Argentina 12 months ago, a Brazil that has not initiated impeachment proceedings. Today, we are not only have just constitutionally appointed, because he was not elected, you know, leader in Brazil, we also have an appointed leader in the UK, which was not elected. So a lot of issues about Brexit and the US, and why is this? Where are we going back to Brazil? Because Brazil is a systemically relevant emerging market economy, as well as Mexico, the only two in Latin America, systemically relevant for the world. Brazil has gone through a major, major systemic crisis, both politically, socially, economic, financial markets. But at the end of the day, the rest of the world has barely been unfazed by that. Why? And that's courtesy of the US Federal Reserve, the Bank of England, the ECB, the Bank of Japan, that kept interest rates an ultra-low level or negative interest rate environment for a long time. Ladies and gentlemen, that's it, that's the past. 12 months from now, negative interest rates, maybe will be in some countries, but clearly not in the US. So then there's gonna be some movement of capital flows. Brazil, how a country that has gone through massive change, and I'm gonna just put the numbers here, if I may, if I find it, thank you for my, and this is the returns of last year by asset class. I have to put my glasses, you know, age doesn't come easily here. The foreign exchange market 12 months ago, the Brazilian real appreciated against the US dollar by 27%. The Mexican peso over the last 12 months declined by 18%. So between the Mexican, so you could say that the Brazilian real almost appreciated versus Mexico, a key member of the Pacific Alliance, something we have to talk about that later, by almost 40%. What's going on with a country that is in deep recession, you know, in with, I would say, political transition to a regime change? Brazil is about regime change. It's not a change of government. The regime is changing. And regimes, in order to change, take usually more than one government elected. It requires a transition. So, and then, interesting enough, the Argentine peso appreciated, you know, in real terms, more, you know, than the Mexican peso. What's going on? So here's one thing. when we were talking about being right or wrong 12 months ago, the idea is not to be right or wrong, it's to identify the right variables and start just focusing on the world, not focusing on what the media is telling us. China is relevant. There has been a second Brexit in the world. One is Britain exit from the European Union, and the one is Brazilian exit from this regime, you know, that has been Partido de Trabalhadores forever. It's a process that will lead to sustainable growth in a country like Brazil, the eighth largest economy based on PPP terms today, you know, over the next 5 and 10 years. So I'm quite bullish on the prospects for Brazil. Instead of focusing on Lavajato, corruption, or the next CEO who's going to be in jail, there has been a lot of issues about financial market stress that we need to highlight as well. I quote the Financial Times of London in an article a month ago. They put together that, you know, around 7-8 major financial institutions have had to pay fines to the Department of Justice and the Financial Conduct Authority in the UK in the order of $70 billion because of misconduct. So again, there are issues happening in terms of misconduct and in other parts of the developed world. Brazil, in a nutshell, the view ahead still is in fiscal emergency. You know, consolidated public sector deficit of the country is 9.3% of GDP. That's the latest information. Inflation, yeah, is coming down, 6.5% over the last 12 months, 5% ahead. The interest rate normalization process that the US will go, you know, as we speak, with Fed funds rates going higher, the Copom in Brazil will be exactly the opposite. Interest rates will go lower. The hefty returns that we had in Brazil over the last 12 months will not be repeated in 2017. It's a year of normalization and preparation for the most important election that Latin America will have in 2018. Both Mexico and Brazil will have elections. And I'll keep it there.
Thank you. Ken, if I could just add a few comments on Brazil. I think we're well aware of all the risks in,
and most of the news in Brazil is negative, but I want to point out four positives. One is the fact that although the energy markets around the world will remain muted in terms of price increases because of the American energy expansion, the base metals, we should see gradual increases as the Americans and the Indians, in particular, lead the world's expansion of infrastructure. That will be good for Brazil as iron ore producer. Another positive is under Temer, there is a complete turnaround in Brazil's attitude towards free trade. And whether that's closing the deal with the Europeans, possibly some sort of movement towards unifying Mercosur and the Pacific Alliance, which Trump could certainly help accelerate. What that does is if you look across Latin America and the countries that have improved their competitiveness, that have made the tough reforms on taxes, on labor, et cetera, they all did it out of economic pressure from free trade. So if you look back over the last 20 years, Mexico perhaps too abruptly exposed itself to free trade, but what survived out of the corporate sector in Mexico today is very competitive. If the same can happen in Brazil, and that brings on reforms that are certainly well noted and we've been talking about for 30 years, the competitive pressures of free trade would certainly help push that in the right direction. Another positive factor, and I think Jonathan spoke to it very well, is, you know, Brazil's unique from the rest of the region in that you have a corporate sector that is dynamic and does not cling to family ownership the way it does in most of the rest of Latin America. What does that mean? It means that the flow of capital, of particularly foreign capital, in and out of the corporate sector in Brazil is unique to anywhere else in the region. And much of the corporate sector in Brazil became overexposed to US dollar denominated debt over the last 10 years. And that has obviously turned into a real liability. And that has spurred a lot of the movement, a need for capital injections, which for the moment can only come from foreigners because of the lack of support for the banking system internally. So again, for investors looking around where you can make a big splash, Brazil stands out. It has for many years and even more so today. And the last factor, which is tough to measure, but is there's no question we're at a unique point in history, and that is the independence of the Brazilian judiciary and the federal prosecution's ability to pursue their work in spite of political pressures against them. I mean, let's compare what happened after the American financial crisis and the fact that two people were put in prison in that entire process versus over 100 major political and corporate figures in Brazil who've been put in prison. And that causes a lot of anxiety to investors in the short term, but in the long term for a country like Brazil, that's incredibly important. We all understand the importance of an independent judiciary, an independent press in terms of the foundation of democracy and long-term stability. So it's sort of a penance that Brazil has to pay, but it's the first country to do it. And if it turns out to pay dividends politically, socially, then hopefully it will be the spark that leads a fire in other countries.
Thank you, John.
In the event that we hosted for President Cardoso about a month ago, I mean, that last point was a point that came out and one that I had talked about, and President Cardoso had talked about that it's hard to imagine any other country in the world that would have allowed these kinds of prosecutions to continue and wouldn't have closed them down a lot sooner. I can't, unfortunately, think of any other country in the world that I know that would have allowed that to happen.
After the PT had nominated most of the Supreme Court judges, they turned around and impeached, or at least allowed the impeachment of Dilma. So, I mean, I'm not even sure that would happen in the States.
Right. we'll probably find out.
We will find out.
All right, let's stay in the Southern Cone. And go to Argentina. I know, Pablo, this is something which is so near and dear to your heart. The government's been in place for about a year now. There's been ambitious plans, not plans, but actually programs, many implemented, some attempted to be implemented. A recent change of the finance minister. How's Argentina doing? Where is it going? Where might it be going? And also with views towards the elections coming up in the midterm election, not the midterm, but the congressional elections coming up.
Thank you, Ken. Well, as you all know, Argentina and the Southern Cone, Brazil, parts of Brazil and Chile as well, we have the opposite seasons, right? So, you know, our Christmas is summer. And summer is always, quite a turbulent time in Argentina, particularly during political and economic issues, because that's when the governments decide to introduce changes, when the Argentines are a bit deflecting their attention to where they're going to go on vacation, usually to Uruguay, right?
Yeah.
Or in Brazil, depending on the exchange rate, or in Miami for some. But the bottom line is this December was not focused on the a championship of polo, in which Argentina is, as you know, very good. It's usually in December, but it was focused on what is called el blanqueo, which is the tax amnesty, which it has been labeled as one of the most successful, transactions in history of tax amnesties, compared even against the Italians, which is the legacy. You know, they were the ones who invented tax amnesties, by the way. They continue to do it, So Argentina, according to the latest data, and this is a very important factor because it's all connected with two or the three key macroeconomic priorities. We will talk about social and political issues as well, but macroeconomic priorities. Argentina, as Brazil, is a country in fiscal emergency. They are an intensive care unit in terms of fiscal situation, and they need to address that both cyclically, politically, and structurally. And that takes into account measures that will be affecting the population at large, the corporate sector, small or large, and particularly the people of Argentina. So the tax amnesty, just to give you an idea, as of now they have received $100 billion, in terms of U.S. equivalent. So it will be based on Canadian dollars. I don't know, but Canadian dollar continues to devalue. So I don't know, around 135 billion Canadian dollars, just in the last couple of months. This ends in March, which means that some estimates are that Argentina may have in that tax amnesty around $130 billion. That means that 10%, between 10 and 15% of that goes to the fiscal in terms of revenue. It's a one-off situation, okay? But more importantly, sets a precedent that a topic that affects the region as a whole, which is capital repatriation. Capital repatriation is coming through policy measures affecting the financial services industry. When I mentioned before the whole issue of these developed country financial institutions being fined, you know, by all these regulators in the US and the UK, is because the global financial sector is structurally changing, and keeping money abroad, you know, without being declared, probably it's something of the past. That is going to be a boon in many, many countries in Latin America and Argentina. The Argentines are just showing that can be fast. So that's one, tax amnesty. Second issue is the fiscal emergency, as I mentioned, requires structural reforms and investments. A major announcement, besides the replacement of the finance minister, which to me, with all the respect, is immaterial in the case of Argentina for the first time. Actually, I think that, you know, over time it's going to be a good decision, you know, to split the finance ministry in two, as they did in Treasury, you know, and the public credit. So it's in finance and Treasury. That's very important. But it's the announcement of President Macri, you know, actually yesterday, about this new investment in the shale, resources industry, in which Canada can play a role. You know, so that's beginning. The energy sector is critical for the country, as you all know, have the second largest natural gas reserves in terms of shale, you know, in the world. So that's untapped and developed. And of course, a macroeconomic environment with the third topic that I'm going to mention, which is hyperinflation at 40%, is not sustainable. You know, so they need to bring inflation down. They need to do in structural reforms, on the fiscal side, which is usually very challenging in the case of Argentina, because, as you all know, Argentina has a quite militant, combative union system, you know, which is part of the power. You know, using, you know, again, Jonathan's comment about the corporate sector in Brazil, you know, in both in Argentina and Brazil, the families have a lot of economic power, but the unions in Argentina are a factor of power. So they need to cohabit with them, and that the good thing about the deal that was announced yesterday was, seems to be a bit of an agreement with some of the unions affecting the energy sector. They want to liberalize the energy sector. Again, the connection between Canada, and that's why we're talking here, we're in Toronto, in Canada, and between Canada and Argentina, is sector by sector basis. It's not a countrywide issue. It doesn't matter if the prime minister went to Argentina or not. It's which sectors you can connect. Energy, mining, infrastructure, you know, and clearly agribusiness. There are four key sectors in which Canadian corporations should take a quick look at the time, you know, when watching Argentina. Macroeconomic priorities, 2017, I would like to sit here in 12 months' time and tell you that inflation came down to 20%. And this is not a sarcastic comment, this is a reality. You know, the inflation in the city of Buenos Aires is ending, you know, the year around 41%, and the country as a whole around 40. So this is, again, urgency. Bring that down. It's not about the finance ministry, it's about the central bank, which in my view, the central bank is doing the right things. There's no a lot of patience, you know. Well, let's go back to social issues and how the society is responding. Argentines have thick skin at the time of dealing with political turmoil, economic turmoil, and all that stuff. And you can see that in the rugby team, by the way, you know, but that aside. Very, very thick skin, and they can go, but the patience is running out. So then the administration of President Macri should be depersonalized. So probably the replacement of the finance minister, I would take that as a positive. The message is, we are a team. We're not just like, we don't want Maradonas, you know, we want, you know, Davis Cup teams, you know, like, because the Davis Cup, as you know, again, Argentina won the Davis Cup, you know, this year, you know, so anyway, just what's going on with me. But you told me that it was, but that's true. It's more a team-based approach, that's a change. And similar to Brazil, I think we're seeing in Argentina the seeds, or planting the seeds of a regime change. A regime that has been in the country for more probably than 60 years. The regime changes, it doesn't have a name, even though the Argentines love to call them peronistas. It's more than that. It's the state intervention in economic activity, creating all these volatile periods of distress so that they can just be reelected, you know, under different names. Left, right, center, can be Menem, Kushner, did I say Kushner? No, that's not our name.
That's a different name.
But there's a bit some analogy here, you know, just the Kushner administration that is coming in the U.S., by the way. So then I think Argentina, 2017 is a transition year. It's an election year to a degree. I think we don't have to put too much of a weight as in the past to the election. I think we have to see what they do. This is run, the macro administration is not an administration of talking a lot, they're doing a lot. 12 months ago, we didn't have an exchange rate. We have two exchange rates, now we have one. We didn't have the normalized relations with the global creditor community that we have. We have had the visit of two members, you know, of the NAFTA, you know, zone, you know, official visits to Argentina. President Obama in March and the Prime Minister of Canada that, you know, you visited, you know, Argentina with him as well. So then this is the new Argentina, clearly recognized. So for the first time, the IMF will publish real numbers, you know, so in terms of inflation, growth and the like. So again, a lot has been done. Much, much more has to be done the year ahead. I think it's transition. And if they continue to do this, then we have the opportunity to see a bit of a, you know, the light of a structural change to a new regime, and perhaps aligning that with the Brazil that may come, Argentina and Brazil together may be great stories for the next 5 to 10 years. That would be my.
Thank you. Just a quick follow-up question, yeah. And so it's your belief that Argentines will give this government more time to start seeing the turnaround and the benefits of the new regime, the new thinking, and how much time do you think they'll give them?
That's good. I think it's the fact that they're giving them their money, it's a good first step, you know? So, as I said before, the Argentines do have not a lot of patience, thick skin, so they don't expect anything. So, my opening remarks were with the tax amnesty because there are real dollars, you know, and they are coming. And this is not money from Canadian foreign direct investors or pension funds in Canada. This is money from Argentines residing in Miami or in Geneva or in Canada, whatever, going back. And those going back, let's put it this way, being declared. Then this is the second wave. They believe there can be between $400 and $500 billion of money abroad. So when they seen that, there has been a positive contagious attitude that will translate into real estate investments, banking sector, activity. Just to give it as an aside, domestic credit as percent of GDP in Argentina is around 15%. In Chile, it's over 100% of GDP. Okay, so imagine the potential. So this country is not growing, but also it doesn't have, you know, the financial intermediation mechanisms put in place to grow. So we need stability. We need confidence, and I think the confidence you need to watch what Argentines do, Ken. And again, it's a gradual process. And I find the 14 months of this administration very pragmatic. And we've seen this with the elimination of subsidies or taxes on agro exports, and some of them being reversed. And that was heavily criticized. Today, maybe that was a good decision, you know? Just pragmatic, flexible. But it was like maybe three steps forward, one backwards, and then two forwards. But it seems that the wheel is starting just to be in motion again. So that would be my.
Yeah, and another factor probably working in their favor is if they're a little bit dissatisfied, they consider what the alternative is. And as long as there's a continual parade of the former president and ministers into the prosecutor's office and more prosecutions for corruption, probably gives a little bit more political space for the Macri government to operate, one might imagine.
It is true. I would again, undervalue the fact that perhaps many people may go to jail in Argentina. It's just the prosecution is fine. It's just the press is very, very open in Argentina. I think, you know, you read La Nación, it's an outstanding newspaper, you know, so you can see. And it's not measuring by people going to jail that you will see Argentina moving. It's, yes, you want transparency and you want precedence, but this is not, I don't think it's like Brazil. I don't think it's like Brazil in this respect, but I think the will is in motion. But again, do not underestimate the major problem that Argentina has had in the past, which is high inflation. 40% inflation as a starting point in January 2017 is not a minor issue. It's very important. So that is a key objective. Right.
Thank you. I'd like, if there's no more comments about Argentina, I'd like to turn to the Pacific Alliance, which is a region, obviously, it's also very near and dear to a number of the people sitting in this room in Canada in general. And maybe, Inés, you could just give an overview of what you think is we might look forward to in the Pacific Alliance.
Great, but before that, two things. And as part of the conversation that is taking place in the region, and I think it's very positive and is very much tied to the cases of corruption that we've had, et cetera, it's a conversation about tax evasion. And that is something that needs to be reformed. Our estimates show that for 2015, tax evasion in the region amounted to 6.7% of GDP. So we are hoping that in the years to come, some reforms will be taking place. And that's starting to be part of the conversation. And that's something that we're looking forward. And then the next comment is with respect to Pablo. You talked about Maradona. Pablo, it's Messi. You're showing your age if you talk about Maradona. It's Messi. Okay, Pacific Alliance. It has generated a lot of interest. Just a brief numbers for those of you that are not very familiar with it. It was formed 5-6 years ago by Chile, Colombia, Peru, and Mexico. And it's significant in terms of just some statistics. It's about 31% of the population of the region, about 35% of the GDP of the region, and they account for more than 50% of the total exports of Latin America and the Caribbean. Of course, Mexico has a huge weight in these numbers. And they are also home to some of the most important multinational corporations, Latin American-based multinational corporations, and they attract investment, et cetera. Now, they are very dynamic in terms of exports, and they are among the leading countries in the region in terms of having bilateral free trade agreements with other countries in the world. Now, what is very interesting is that trade among those economies, intra-regional trade, is very low. It's just 4%, and that's one of the challenges that the countries have. Now, I think that it's very important to understand that the Pacific Alliance, the main objective of the Pacific Alliance was to relate to Asia-Pacific. It's really a platform that would enable those countries to better relate and have better linkages with the Asia-Pacific. And that is because of the changes that have been taking place in the world economy, and the Pacific Alliance has to be understood in terms of those changes, the rise of global value chains, the fact that Latin America and the Caribbean does not have a very important presence in global value chains, and when we have a presence, we have either we are supplying raw materials or we are assembling, but we are not in the middle segments of the global value chains, which are the ones that are important from the point of view of technology, et cetera. Now, they have advanced significantly since 2011-2012 when they have formed, and just last year they signed a protocol whereby there's a very interesting agenda among themselves of harmonization, accumulation of origin, and trade facilitation. I mean, the point is that it will even get easier to do business with Pacific Alliance countries, and it will be easier for them to trade and invest within the intra-regional community. But they have, of course, huge challenges for productive integration, because as I said, just 4% of intra-regional trade takes place among those four countries. But they are moving towards a trade facilitation agenda. Two key challenges, how they are going to develop an approach towards Asia. They have been having joint missions and going to joint events and trade promotion in Asia. Also, in the case of Africa, they've opened a joint business agency in Africa. But will they develop a joint agenda towards Asia? That's a big question mark. In order also to be more attractive to Asia. The country that is most attractive to Asia in the region is Brazil. But Asia and China is extremely important for Chile, Peru. China is the most important trading partner for Chile and Peru, and it's among the number two for the other countries. So How will they develop an agenda towards Asia Pacific? That's something to see. They are very interested, and I expect in the years to come for closer ties between the Pacific Alliance and Asia, as well as for other Latin American countries. I think that the changes that we're going to see is that countries will seek closer ties with Asia Pacific. And the other challenge is what will happen within Latin America and the Caribbean. Will there be some type of conversation between the Pacific Alliance and Mercosur? That would be ideal. Already we have Uruguay as an observer of the Pacific Alliance. There have been conversations between Bachelet and Macri. And we're hoping that some type of convergence could start taking place in the years to come, at least start by some type of measures that would facilitate trade between Mercosur and the Pacific Alliance. Of course, something absolutely key is whether there's a conversation and a conversation that advances between Brazil and Mexico. Those are the two key countries in that respect. And also the other question mark is what will happen with all the observers to the Pacific Alliance. The Pacific Alliance has 49 observers. I mean, there are 10 more times observers than members of the Pacific Alliance. And will some type of approach be developed with respect to those observers? Costa Rica is already trying to become a member of the Pacific Alliance, and Panama would also like to do that. So we see a very promising future of the Pacific Alliance. They are very pragmatic, and that's very important. Very pragmatic, and the private sector, very driven by the interest of the private sector. So that's very good. Let me finish with that.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, John.
I just add a bit of a contrarian view on Pacific Alliance. having talked to leaders in different countries and their vision of the Pacific Alliance, what I was struck by was the lack of unity of what is ahead for the, what began as a very promising idea, and there's certainly, you know, the amount of observers, I think, is a testament to that. But there's clear that half the people leading the Pacific Alliance want it to be a platform to reach out to Asia, want to bring in other members around the world. The other half says no. What we want to do is deepen our integration between these four economies by sector, harmonize regulations, so that investors who look, instead of looking at one of our countries, look at all four of our countries and can envision different parts of the value chain of their businesses across those borders. Couple that with the fact that Mexico is now a deer in the headlights, completely transfixed by Trump and worried. They are sort of, you know, they have some low-level sort of bureaucrats working on the Pacific Alliance, but the powerful people who run Mexico are not worried about Pacific Alliance right now. They're worried about the U.S. So I think what makes Pacific Alliance, what made it work, was that all four countries had in place for several years free trade agreements with the Americans, the Canadians, and some of them with the I think all of them with the Europeans as well. That provided a period of time of adjustment that forced corporations in those countries to compete on the global stage. It provided years of enforcement mechanisms driven by their partner trading partners, such that dumping and breaking the rules was quickly castigated. So all four of those countries were ready and working on an even playing field with pretty functioning customs unions, et cetera. It was easy to bring them together. Trying to couple that with Mercosur, the most dysfunctional trade agreement on the planet, it may make political sense, and certainly with Trump and the sort of nativist sentiment in Europe, there's a certain political instinct to bind together. But the logistics of making Mercosur speak with Pacific Alliance countries, the fact that the customs unions in both Brazil and Argentina are a disaster. I was part of a study where we shipped cartons of paper from Brazil to 10 countries around the world. And it was a study for a client to test to see which would arrive and how much time and et cetera. We were able to ship, first of all, to get a $10 parcel out of Brazil, on average cost $300 to $500 in terms of shipping agent fees to produce all the paperwork to send 500 sheets of paper. We were able to successfully send them to China, to Dubai, to Europe, other parts of Asia. The shipment to Argentina got stuck there for 2 months, and they wanted a $700 bribe to release it. In Colombia, it got lost. And in Mexico, we kept going between different bureaucracies until after 3 months, we just gave up. So that's the reality. Politically, there's a great argument to bind these systems together. But the mechanics of doing so are so difficult and so unprepared in the case of Mercosur that as much as politically it makes sense, I'm not sure that they can actually make it happen.
I agree. I mean, that's why I said they do not have, they want to relate to Asia. They do not have a common agenda. Countries are looking bilaterally. Now, what you're saying is absolutely right in terms, that's why the agenda for trade facilitation, it's absolutely crucial. I mean, they already have 93% or more of their trade liberalized. So there's not, it's not about tariffs. It's really about making easier to trade among themselves. Now, there are elements where they whereby they could integrate, but it's tough. I mean, they are, because of the nature of the economies, they are in services, for example. That's one area that I think they could do more things in services together. That's an area that could be expanding, hopefully. Yeah.
I would also say, if our colleague from the TMX were here, Nick Thadney, who's a member of our board, he would probably say that the potential or prospect for financial integration is probably greater than in the goods and even the services area. Mila, the stock market, I wouldn't say harmonization is probably not the right word, but achieving the same standard and having dual listing and triple listing and even quadruple listing probably is likely to advance more quickly. Now, there is a epistemological question as to whether financial integration leads to goods and services integration or vice versa. I think that could be a whole day seminar. But I do think that things will happen in that regard, which incidentally is very important for Canada, because Canada is likely the common place for energy and particularly metals companies that would be listing and not big enough in their own markets, but could list in Toronto and dual list in their own country. So it's a very important Canadian angle to that Mila question, I think.
I understand that Uruguay and Chile have already formalized free trade agreements, you know, negotiations. So with or without Mercosur, with or without Pacific Alliance, I think that's a major step, showing that Chile is not trapped into the Pacific Alliance mood. It's just, they're going to just, and Uruguay, Chile, that can be perhaps a good precedent. Second one, going to Jonathan's comments about goods, services, integration. Yeah, I agree. You know, I think talking about between Mercosur and Pacific Alliance, as even just chatting, it's just a utopia. But there's sectors that can just be, you know, probably more integrated. And I think from a Canadian standpoint, we need just to figure out which sectors Canada really, really is competitive, you know, just to interact with all those countries and probably follow more a sectoral approach. You know, I'm just an advocate of that. I am probably not necessarily for, you know, this countrywide trade, investment, environmental agreements, but a sector. And the third observation is, you go to Argentina and go to their universities, and they're filled with Colombians, filled with Peruvians, filled with Chileans. And you know what? They are, some of them, already establishing the roots. So I would say, in your philosophical observation about good service integration, why don't we just, you know, start with York University and integrating, you know, programs between the top engineering school in Mexico, with the top engineering school in Brazil, with the top engineers in Canada, instead of just focusing too much into this, you know, broad-based, corporate-only focused. Because at the end of the day, the new generation is the one who's going to make change. The generation of my three children, you know, who are Canadian, well, they're dual citizens and fully bilingual right now. And they're not focusing about, you know, only passports and flags. They're just focusing about where they can go in exchange. And again, I think never underestimate, you know, the educational aspect of freedom of movement. And in that respect, Argentina has opened universities, you know, to the whole Americas. Even Canadians can go and study for free, by the way, if you have kids or you're interested, you know, in doing some studies there.
I wanted to go move right to specific countries, but let me interject one thing now because it's come up. Mercosur, in particular Argentina, has been a big advocate of trying to get Canada to sign an agreement with Mercosur. Brief responses or reactions to whether or not that makes sense for Canada. Jonathan?
Sure. So, wonderful in theory. I actually think that the issue is Brazil. I'm not sure it's Argentina, to be honest. I mean, Argentina looking for friends. I mean, clearly, I mean, you know, they're pretty lonely down there, scraping the bottom of the world. So,
Argentines say that they have the Brazilians on board with.
Well,
that
they
kind
say,
of
but I see, Itamaraty is so schizophrenic as it relates to its relationship to Canada, the United States too, frankly, but Canada, probably in a way, has more challenge because it's not very big, frankly. And pretty far away, and so I every conversation I've ever had with officials in the foreign arena in Brazil has always been highly conceptual and without any real detail. And I think it has to do not only with the schizophrenia of the foreign diplomatic establishment in Brazil, which doesn't really know whether it wants to be insular or outward looking or blah blah blah, but it also has to do with public choice. Canada, you know, it gets slotted into this category of competitor and not cooperator. And I think that that's a function of you know, if you would have just read headlines about trade with the United States and Canada, you'd think softwood lumber was 58% of the Canadian economy. Well, it's not. It's 0.4. So, you know, the same thing is true as it relates to aerospace in Brazil and Canada. So I think there's a political level. There's not only just a leadership required, but there's also a mindset change required. And I don't see really anybody in the elites in Brazil currently who really know anything about Canada or really care much about Canada. So I think that might be a big stumbling block.
John, do you want to say something about it?
No.
I think it's out. I would just literally repeat word by word and in concept and in literature what Jonathan has said, but add, I think the focus of sector and even go, you know, just one level lower in terms of sectors, see where are the sectors that have been successful in Canada and again, in each of those countries. And I don't want to just talk about Argentina, but we can talk about Brazil. You say aerospace or the auto industry. Should we go all original equipment manufacturer? We can go auto parts. Why not? Why not focusing on bilateral sectorial, you know? Even, and what I'm against when it's called a side agreement. A side agreement is immaterial because it's side to the main agreement. Make it the core agreement. As 1965 was the pact between the US, you know, and Canada on the other side. So why not? And start small and see the good success stories of the agribusiness in Argentina. I was told by the finance minister of Colombia that they're seeing, you know, the model of the agribusiness in Argentina trying to implement in Colombia once the FARC leave their territory. Why? Because the Argentines know about agribusiness. How about the ethanol industry in Brazil? How about software development in Canada? Why do we have to go all this massive tax paid money, you know, throwing out of the garbage just to years of negotiations, and then usually the one with the bigger muscle just dictates the rules.
Okay. At least from the point of view of some countries in Mercosur, there will be a great appetite for things that you said before, science, technology, innovation, some type of agreement, exchanges on that. That would be magnificent.
Fantastic. Let's go, let's try and in the time we have, bore down into some specific countries. The most outward looking in terms of trade agreements is in the region we're talking about is Chile. But Chile is a bit going through a bit of a malaise, I think it's fair to say, and people are looking to see what's going to happen in the elections at the end of the year. So there's a lot going on in that arena. Jonathan, do you want to talk a little bit about where you see Chile going in the next year?
Sure. I think you put your finger on it. I mean, it may be a malaise, but you know, in a way, that's a high-class problem currently in the global economy. Chile, I think, has graduated to a level where it's the volatility for an investor, the volatility for a capital markets investor, is more representative of a developed market type experience. So Chile will grow maybe 0.5% less or 0.5% more than, you know, we had expected. I would say that there is a underlying, and it goes back to a comment that Pablo made, which is there is an underlying potential bid for copper, which I think will probably, on the margin, help them and probably allow them a little bit more fiscal room to do what they are still dead set on doing, which is to address the social deficits in the country, which is still, I mean, we just met, with, as you know, the economy minister was just here. We had a private meeting, and it was clearly the top of mind that they are still very focused on this, that they think this is the pathway to a political success in the next election. So I think that is probably a little bit of a tailwind, albeit within the context of some uncertainties globally. The other thing about in Chile is I think that past disciplines will pay dividends, I think, in the next few years. So the, you know, the Chileans did a few really smart things that they more or less stuck with, and I think any government that would come into power would most likely stick with as well. Stabilization fund, you know, they dipped a bit, but they really didn't grotesquely affect the cushion that it provides. They have made very substantial infrastructure investments, many of which actually Ontario Teachers has made with them. And they have pretty darn good infrastructure in a country that you need it because it breaks every so often because it, you know, the whole country shakes every 10 years. And finally, I think this is probably the most important point. There is a, despite, you know, and anyone who knows anything about Chilean politics, I mean, the personal rancor is like unbelievable. It's not unbelievable having gone through the U.S. election. It's actually now considerably tame. But nonetheless, there is, if you get yourself tied up in the what seem to be huge differences between the different political constructions in the country, you'd think that these people absolutely hate each other and never will do anything to push the country forward. But in effect, it doesn't happen that way. And even, you know, we remember, Ken, we were very very focused in 2 years ago, our forward-looking panel about the growth of the strong left wing, shall we say, of the present government, and that there was a seeming drift towards more ideological type approaches, particularly as it related to the tax issue and related to foreign investors in the tax issue, which is a big issue that John, I know, is very focused on. It was a big splash. It was a very talked about question. Conversations were had, both foreign and domestic. It went away. So I think that, again, this is the graduation to a more less sophomoric and far more mature political environment. So I have to say, Chile to me is steady as she goes.
Speaking of political rancor, John, you want to talk a little bit about Peru?
Sure. you know, I mean, it wasn't that long ago that we were all sort of, and the whole world was gushing with optimism about Kuczynski's presidential win and what this meant for Peru and what a stand-up guy he is, and he's incorruptible, and this is exactly what Peru needs. But we forgot that in Peru, politics is a blood sport. You know, if you go back to Papa Fujimori's time, as he was engaged in really a civil war with leftist rebels, he built up an entire intelligence industry of professionals and technology that tapped the phones of, you know, hundreds of people involved in the insurgency movement. Well, those skills and those people and that technology never left. And so what you have today in Peru is anyone who's powerful, whether it's the government, the opposition, or big business, is tapping one another's phones. In fact, if your phone is not tapped in Peru, you're just not important. So it's little wonder that one minister was caught diddling his intern. Another was caught in a conversation promising money to a big vendor. And so what we have is a sort of a show of naivete by the PPK government in an environment where Keiko Fujimori should not be, you know, a friend of mine in Miami was her roommate in college. And as she put it, this is a person who cannot handle loss of face. And the election defeat, which then was analyzed around the world as, isn't, gosh, aren't we lucky we got the right guy, and thank goodness we didn't vote for Fujimori, and, you know, the cast of characters supporting her, that was such a loss of face to her that I think that the forced resignation of the Minister of Education, who is a great, you know, considered widely across Peru as the most successful minister of the last administration, the only minister to survive the Humala transition, is simply her way of getting back, flexing her political muscle, showing that her party, that all things that happen in Peru must pass through her congressional control. And so much of the, I think the PPK government is now kind of being brought down to earth, and we will see a much more modest show going forward. We will see some sharing of the benefits, let's put it that way, of what will be, what promises to be a massive investment in infrastructure, both publicly funded, but more importantly, privately funded. I mean, Peru is already the most privately funded sort of infrastructure jurisdiction in Latin America. I saw a map recently that showed the different claims or plots of land that are up for bidding between the gas and oil and other and infrastructure sectors, and it was like the entire country was spoken for. Fujimori does not want to miss out on that bonanza, and so I don't want to call it corruption. You can determine what you want to call it, but he is going to have to play the game, and he is going to have to share the spoils politically and probably financially with her party. So is that good or not for Peru? From a sort of idealistic point of view, it's negative, but you know, from a pragmatic point of view, I think that the honeymoon is over. He got knocked out in the second round, and he's coming back, but he will be much more cautious in how he interacts with the with Congress and with her party. The private sector very much believes in Peru. When I was down speaking at the MILA conference in October, which is a big mining investment conference, and I was very impressed by the Minister of Mining, who pointed out that the number of bureaucratic processes that one must go through to get permissions to explore a mine had grown from 20 to over 200 over the last 7 years, and that he planned to simplify things. And I think that much like the Macri administration in Argentina, there is a business mindset in the PPK administration to simplify things, to make it easier for business. So that is a very positive. And if I think they can work better with their congressional foes, then all of the positive outlooks that we had 6 months ago will still materialize.
Thank you. We have a few minutes left. We want to get to Colombia and Mexico and Mexico and still have time for some questions. So, Pablo, maybe you could say a couple words about Colombia, please.
Yeah, a couple of words. There have been major events happening this year in Colombia, and I would say that even though the world has focused on the recent congressional approval of the peace accord, I think we cannot be naive and not place value on how Colombians voted on October the 2nd. On September 26th, I was in Bogota, was the day that they announced the signing of the peace agreement, all dressed in white, major fanfare in Cartagena. September 26th, it looked like a Reveillon in Brazil, all in white. And a few days later, you know, the people of Colombia decided to reject the agreement. And more importantly, on October the 2nd, and here's an interesting point, I'm not focusing on what has been approved a couple days ago, really, literally, is we need to understand the context in which we operate, not necessarily the acts of government. And that was an act of government or Congress, but from an act of context is very important. Then on October 2nd, there were three votes, you know, one vote for the peace accords, one vote against the peace accords, and the third vote, in my humble opinion, was the most important, which was the not vote. And the not vote was 63% of the Colombian electorate. It's not immaterial that 63% of the Colombian people do not trust their leadership or the established leadership. Neither the president in power, the official opposition, you know, under, you know, the strengths of former President Uribe. That is what I take as of major importance. Then, of course, what do we do with that? And what they do it is, okay, I'm not going to ask people anymore. So I asked them through a plebiscite. Then I decide, okay, I cannot do anything because it's a binding. So then I'm not going to ask anymore. And then they pass that. So then the situation is still there. So going into 2017, those 63% of the Colombians still do not necessarily put a lot of credibility on what's happening. Of course, the peace accords were signed, you know, by an act of Congress and negotiated between Congress and government. Again, the people, you know, put aside. We can call that democracy or not, you know. We can, it's up to all of us to assess that. Second issue there was, the most important thing about Colombia is, you know, and we analyzed the context, you know, of Colombia, which is still the non-FARC, non-drug-related economy, which continues to do fairly well, and that's what we should still focus in on. And then the structural tax reform that has been approved by the Congress, it's the most important event in Colombia, you know, of this year. And that structural tax reform, you know, creates the necessarily the obligation of many people in Colombia to start paying taxes. Who in Canada pay taxes? All of us. Because if we're not, we're punished. Who paid in Colombia taxes? Not a lot of people, because they're not punished. Okay, so now that structural tax reform, which probably alleviates a bit of the burden on the corporate sector in terms of tax, which is good for business, but puts a lot of pressure on individuals. And there are a lot of wealthy individuals in Colombia. Control, again, we're talking about the non-FARC, non-oil, non-drug-related economy. So it's an economy that should be growing probably twice as much as they're growing, just barely will grow by 2% this year, if so. And perhaps like that next year, because the structural tax reform will trickle down. Second observation, and I will just clearly liaise with Peru. I was once told by the Minister of Finance of Peru that informality in Peru is 70%. And in Colombia is around 50 or 60. So informality is an issue. It's not a development issue. It's a real pragmatic economic, you know, issue. So addressing that, all financial market reform, all incentives, and you don't bring an informal economy, Peru 70%, to, I don't know what we in Canada, 95%, you know, Jonathan?
No, we're no idea. Eh? Is that including or excluding my renovation?
Yeah, or the sausage vendors. But anyway, so but clearly it's not an issue overnight, but that is a pending issue for the region in terms of socioeconomic development and growth potential in the future. And we will all benefit, the corporate sector, the society, the financial sector, everyone. So bringing, and but one thing that is we need to keep in mind, informality votes when voting is mandatory. So going back to Peru, 70% of those who are informal, they go to vote. And I just find very amusing the English language and use of acronyms. PPK, because Pepe, it's like a bit of an issue in Spanish, right? So President Kuczynski, you know, who likes to call himself PPK, you know, really, you know, won by just a few hundred votes.
What I would say is one of the programs that Economy Minister Thorne has introduced is precisely to go after the informal economy and bring them into the economy. Maybe Inés, would you like to say anything about what's been going on in Peru that way?
No, but just what Pablo was saying, this is a huge problem, and not only in Peru has the one that highest statistics in terms of informality, but it's all over Latin America. It's tied to the labor market, it's tied also to regulations, business, etc. And that's as far as I.
We only have a
few minutes left. We haven't discussed Mexico. Mexico, and the reason we are going to do, as the program says, a whole special program, a full morning in February on Mexico and North and the new North American reality and new strategies. But it would be very remiss of us not to at least have a little bit of a discussion about Mexico for the people here, and a bit as a setup for what we will be discussing with representatives from Mexico and the United States and Canada in about a month's time. John, do you want to take a quick cut at Mexico?
Sure. Well, the expression Mexico so far from God, so close to the United States has never been truer. You know, there's four fundamental threats that the U.S. represents to Mexico right now. One is the fact that Trump has promised to throw out TPP and renegotiate NAFTA. Another is to build a wall. Another is to punish through a taxation scheme outsourcing. The other is deportations. I believe, it's dangerous to play the crystal ball at this juncture, but I do believe that he will cancel at least the American involvement in the TPP. I think that his ability to threaten changes to NAFTA, his ability to threaten a taxation on outsourcing, has already proved pretty darn effective at convincing Ford, General Motors, possibly Toyota, Carrier, and others to change their plans, which involved building new factories or shifting factories to Mexico and reinvesting those monies in the United States. The fact is that for most American corporations in the Rust Belt, if you have an old factory, the cost of moving it is often greater than just keeping it there. So it's better to just pare your costs in your Ohio plant and just keep running it in a low-cost manner. But when it comes to expansion, to building new plants, it's so much more compelling to build them in Mexico today than it is in the United States. And not just because of labor, but also taxation, environmental issues. The quality of labor, of manufacturing labor, has radically improved in Mexico, thanks in part to the auto sector that built privately funded training colleges, working with the government to some degree to train those mid-skilled people that they needed. Opening up NAFTA or changing NAFTA, I'm not sure of the legal intricacies of that, what requires congressional support versus what can be done by a presidential edict, to what degree it can be done by one country versus all three countries agreeing to it. But I think that enough of American corporate interests would be hurt by what would be essentially opening a Pandora's box, because it's not just the Americans that want to make changes. The Canadians have their own list of demands. The Mexicans have their own list of demands. As much as the Americans argue that they, have suffered from NAFTA, when you take the 50th most competitive country in the world, Mexico, at the time of signing of NAFTA, and the most competitive country in the world, and the fourth most competitive country in the world, and you put them together, guess who loses out? The Mexican mid-sized corporate sector was destroyed by NAFTA. There used to be thousands of 100 employee plus family-owned businesses in Mexico that no longer exist because of NAFTA. So the Mexicans, by opening NAFTA, not only do you hurt U.S. interests, but that combined with other factors could spur a political reaction in Mexico. And that's something that could be far worse down the road. Building a wall, there already is a wall in portions of the U.S. border with Mexico. It's clear that the Mexicans aren't going to pay for it. And so now Trump is testing the waters to see if U.S. Congress will pay for it and they can somehow tax the Mexicans down the road. The fact is that they will probably militarize the border a little bit more, put up more walls, more monitoring devices, staff it more, etc. And I do believe that the greatest deportation president in U.S. history, Barack Obama, might meet his match with Trump. Obama deported more Mexicans and aliens, as they call them in the States, than all U.S. history, presidents in history combined. The law that exists on the books today, which is that if you have a criminal record, which can be, driving under influence, it can be insulting a public official, it can be speeding, it can be relatively minor offenses. So I don't believe that he will pursue everyone with a criminal record, but he might continue to pursue, and Obama started it, deporting people with a violent criminal record. That would represent about 1 million Mexicans. And depending upon the speed with which he pursues that, that could be impactful. There are there are municipal governments in Texas and California and other states that have set up their own sort of amnesty rules whereby the local police force refuse to enforce any rules that could lead to deportation of foreigners. So there are, it's going to be an interesting constitutional battle between the federal government and local governments as to the legal status and what happens to these people. But all of this, what worries me is actually not what goes on in Washington, but what goes on in Mexico. Because the nativist anti-Yankee sentiment, and I lived in Mexico for 7 years, is very strong, bubbles under a very shallow surface, and with good bloody reason. But that could explode, and we may see an AMLO or somebody even more radical come to power in 2018 who decides, you know what, enough of this. We're going to protect Mexican interests. We're going to put tariffs up, and we're not going to allow American products into our country. So there is a real risk in my mind that the political threats from the United States actually create something worse in Mexico, and that's what worries me. Now, I do believe that U.S. corporate interests will stop NAFTA from being renegotiated, but I do believe that we will see a wall or something of it, and we will see more deportations. But at the end of the day, that doesn't matter to corporate America, and it doesn't matter to corporate Mexico. What matters to them is the fluidity of that border and their ability to move goods back and forth easily. And that will probably be largely preserved while the movement of people will be clamped down further. And that movement of people and the symbolism of that wall will have political repercussions in Mexico.
Let's leave it at that and open the floor to questions about any topic that we discussed or any topic that we didn't discuss. We have a mic here, Marta. Yeah. Okay. Well, why don't we just for purposes of. For purposes of recording it as well. So we have a first question here, and then I'll come to you, sir. And then we'll come to you. Please. Yeah.
Well, I'll make a quick question. I'm the Mexican representative of Bréard for trade and investment. I have a question from the Canada point of view of what you ladies and gentlemen mentioned today. What is the position from the Canadian perspective in relation to Latin America and specific to Mexico from the government perspective, from the business side? Mentioned uncertainty. Do you see all the sectors in that same perspective? What is your view on how Canada sees this?
Are you saying what is the business perspective plus the government perspective on a specific issue in Latin America? On Mexico. In other words, Mexico vis-a-vis what might be happening vis-a-vis the United States, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Like a reopening of NAFTA, that kind of thing.
Well, I'll quickly start. And again, from a Canadian perspective and from a financial services perspective, and I work for an organization that is committed, you know, to Mexico for the long run, and we'll remain committed to that. So we will, we need to understand the context, our context, the way we see strategic context, not economic analysis, is just, you know, beyond Trump, beyond the next election in 2018. We want to see structural shifts. We want to be structural change. One, think we, in our view, Mexico has the potential to grow at double the rate that is growing today. Okay? In order to do so, that's the view. It's not going to happen next year. It's not going to happen the next year. You need to continue the process of structural shifts and structural reforms. Most of them have been happening, but I don't know why. We always focus on this issue. This is Bloomberg, and the peso is trading at $22, 22 pesos per dollar today. This is the only Latin American currency that is crashing as we speak. So is this because of the Trump
Pence-Kushner administration? Did I say Kushner? Yes, I said. So, or is it really because the Fed, the central bank of the United States, will be perhaps more aggressive, you know, raising interest rates? And that's very important to your question. And then all the money, the funds that have been parked in Mexican bond markets, I quote, 60% of long-term bonds trading in Mexico in local currency terms are in the hands of foreigners. Do we believe that systemically the Mexican bond market has room for 60% of foreign holdings? The answer is no. So then that repatriation aspect does not apply to Brazil, Colombia, and Argentina because of doing tax amnesties. It also applies to the repatriation of capital that courtesy of the US Fed, that has not been independent, by the way, over the last few years, you know, from their economic environment and political situations. Now it's normalizing the situation. We don't want interest rates in negative territory in the US. That is devastating for the global financial system. The normalization of that process involves not only normalizing, you know, Fed fund rate policy in the US, but also addressing what they have in terms of bond holdings. That's the US. Mexico, regrettably, will have to adjust to the realities of repatriation. But that does not eliminate our commitment to see Mexico potentially growing at that rate. What we would like to see in Mexico, we would like to see less concentration of wealth on private families. We would like to see the continuation of development of private sector diversified economy, modeling more the Canadian side than the US side, which we know that is not the best in class, by the way. And that is the commitment of long-term capital as the bank that I work for and many other institutions in Canada. So Mexico is a must-stay, a long-term growth potential, but it has challenges. We need to understand what the election cycle is. The presidential election uncertainties of who's going to be elected in the US have been dissipated, but they have already started who's going to be elected. And we all know who will probably be in power if you had elections today in Mexico. Hopefully that will not be the case in July 2018.
Jonathan, you
want to say that? Look, this is one of these cases where the experts will all agree on something and then something else will happen. Because we are in the midst of a transition, not just in economic terms, or in terms of globalization, or I would argue a process of deglobalization. The question is the slope and the severity of the backlash. What we are seeing, and I don't think it would necessarily have to focus on Latin America, but what we're seeing globally is a rejection of some very long-standing assumptions that we have had since pretty much the election of Thatcher and Reagan, and I guess Mulroney as well. And the reality is in Mexico is that it's a system which is still in the forming, and we've seen in the paragon of financial capitalism, the United States, that, you know, the system is swaying because of a political backlash against the verities of globalization. That there is, that automation is good, globalization is good, supply chains are good, and you'll all adjust and it'll be fine. Well, no, there are demographic and other reasons why people are holding up their hand. I think John puts his finger on the issue in Mexico, which is there are these longer term, as Pablo is certainly talking about, longer term structural integration forces that are bringing Mexico, the United States, and Canada, and arguably, I guess, the Alianza Pacifica as well, in certain respects, together. There are energy connectivity, there's connectivity in telecommunications, and there's supply chains in goods, and of course, the overlay of services. Look at the energy map of the United States and Mexico. This is a map that is just, it's like two amoebas just sort of forming into one, particularly as it relates to Texas and the new pipelines. And these are economically extremely important to both parties. I mean, Mexico's whole economic framework is being transformed by the energy integration and by the reform that has, in my opinion, reflected and acknowledged that integration. Having said that, the elites in Mexico are extremely freaked out. So I was just there, and I spent a week there, and just before we went to Argentina. And this is an elite that is really, really concerned. The president is completely inundated with this concern. They're watching the peso every day, and they view it as a measure of what they're going to do. And it doesn't look good, particularly in the context of a president who has relatively low popularity ratings and a government that is looking towards an election and not looking towards a full term ahead. The elites in Mexico, and this is the positive part of my statement, the elites in Mexico have always, always figured out a way of keeping the tail at bay, meaning the negative tail event at bay. It used to be that when it came down to the United States having to write a check in 1994, they said, we will never, ever let that happen again. And so the fiscal rectitude and the conservatism of the macro policy in Mexico began. Unfortunately, Carstens is leaving, but very much an idiom of that particular technocratic elite, as is the Werner and all the other people who are buzzing around that job. That will never happen again, that the United States needs to bail out Mexico. The second thing was the pacto. Arguably, Mexico was looking at a growth deficit and looking at a social impacts of that deficit. And they said, you know what? Everyone through from priestas to periodistas got together and said, look, we've got to do something, because if we don't, the country's going to go down. And that elite pulled together. Now it has become rancorous again, of course. And the Morena part of it is definitely not as part of this pacto. So the question is today is whether those integrationist forces, whether the elites can pull together a country that is, let's face it, very much a government of elites and very not really that integrated with its popular masses. And sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes a bad one. Whether the popular political mentality in Mexico is going to hold up the hand and bring forth an AMLO, or whether the elites are going to be able to coalesce and keep this at bay. And right now what I hear in Mexico is that the elites, and I'm speaking specifically of the panistas and the priestas, are going to get together in some manner to prevent an AMLO presidency, one way or another, because they know that if that is to occur, that will reverse 30 years of history. And I think they'll probably get it done, but it's going to be a close run thing.
Just following up on that, we all talk about the willingness to talk about free trade and liberalization, etc. But around the world, you look everywhere. Brexit, Trump, and China isn't really wants to join too much either. In Latin America, where do they stand? Is this is this going to happen, or are they just are people in these countries going to vote for this and make it happen as you just described?
Question here, and then I think we'll close it. He has his fan down.
Hi, a question for Jonathan, an asset allocation question. Which markets and what assets would you be looking at over the next year and a half? Thank you.
With the asset allocation, we'll finish on the first question that was asked.
Okay, very, very quickly. That this is any sort of authoritative view, but it is an important question, because that's obviously why many of us are here. I think that one of the most interesting, and I think I alluded to this, but one of the most interesting asset classes in Latin America today is credit. Credit markets are reflecting, in my view, a level of distress which is very attractive in Brazil, in Mexico, and in various parts. I wouldn't say Argentina, to be honest. Argentina is probably overpriced at this stage. But unless you dig deep into assets that are not yet really put into the public marketplace. So I think corporate credit, in some respects sovereign, but mainly corporate credit, is extremely interesting for all the reasons we talked about in Brazil, and increasingly in Mexico, because of the stress that's currently being put on the domestic financial market. The only other thing I would say is I do think that, and I wouldn't have said this a year ago, I do think that mineral-related companies in the equity space look cheap. And that is based on a view that that metals will make a recovery due to some of the points that John made earlier.
Yeah, just about the trade question. That's very interesting, globalization, because in fact, at a time where throughout the world there's an anti-globalization sentiment, in the case of Latin America and the Caribbean, that is not happening yet. As a matter of fact, I mean, there have been groups, and as John mentioned, in the case of Mexico and throughout the countries, that have been hurt by some opening of trade, et cetera. But for the most part, at least during the time between 2002 and 2008, the rise in trade, the opening, took place at a time where many sectors benefited. So for them, trade is perceived as something that was positive. I do not see, for the moment, any increase in anti-globalization movement in Latin America, unless the region does not pick up in terms of growth in the years to come, and then maybe the sentiment will change. I see several countries even looking for greater ties with other regions in the world, and I see that maybe even intra-regional integration, there are some hopes, very simple in terms of trade facilitation, things that could take place in the years to come. So for the moment, I do not see an anti-globalization sentiment. In Latin America.
I remember a cab ride I took in Guatemala City a couple years ago, and well, it was more than a few years ago, and CAFTA DR had just been implemented, and it was about 2 years into the implementation. And I asked him, you know, what he thought of this, and cab drivers are great. They're the philosopher kings of the world. If you want to get a quick survey of where a country is going, just talk to a taxi driver. But he said, you know, there's all these political elites in our country who are railing against free trade and think it's a bad thing, but you know, now I can go to Walmart and buy X product for half the price I used to. So that's a good thing. The fact is that free trade has delivered to, and they talked about it in the very close election when the Panistas beat out AMLO, when Garcia won in Peru, they talked about the middle class and the benefits that the middle class has seen from a purchasing power point of view and what that translated into in terms of approval of free trade. In many ways, Latin America already had this debate anywhere from 5 to 10 to 15 years ago, and it was a very tough debate and it was narrowly passed in terms of public support of free trade. So, you know, where does it stand today? I think unless the goalposts move significantly and there's some sort of economic shock that's directly related to trade, that generally, you know, call it 55-60% support across the region should hold.
It's so tempting to end the program on that note, and I'm going to give into that temptation. So I'd like to call on Marta to please close out the event.
First of all, I just want to, again, just ask for a round of applause for our expert panelists. And thank you all for coming out this early morning. It's not too cold here this morning, so that was a nice wake up. And just finally, to reiterate what Ken mentioned during the panel, which is our upcoming event on the new North America. It will be planned for sort of third or fourth week of February. So please keep an eye out for that. And we look forward to welcoming you back to future CCA events throughout the year 2017. So thank you again and a happy new year to all. Thanks.